So hi all, hope you are doing well. So today in the session, I thought we'll discuss some questions relating to company audit for CA final auditing. The main issue with the students is that they tend to lose their mark because of the presentation. So I thought through this video, we'll discuss some recent past exam questions which is asked for the CA final. My intention is to clear two things. One is the presentation, how to write the answers for the exam. The second thing is what institute expects from these questions. So all these questions which I am showing are taken from the past exam questions, the questions relating to company audit for CA final auditing. Okay, so starting with the first question. An auditor of a company registered under Section 8 of Companies Act 2013, you find that as per the notification of Ministry of Corporate Affairs regarding applicability of Ind AS, the company has requested its financial statement for the year ended 31st March 2017 under Ind AS. Now the company has been asked to prepare the financial statement as per the Ind AS. Okay. The management of the company, however, is of the strong view that being a Section 8 company, so it is a Section 8 company, having charitable objectives, Ind AS cannot apply to the said company. So the management feels that since the company is a Section 8 company, you know, non-profit company, it feels that it need not apply Ind AS while preparing the financial statements. And therefore, the financial statements are prepared by the management under earlier GAAP, and a note for the same is given in the financial statements. How do you report on these financial statements? So the requirement of the question is, as an auditor, how do we report in the following cases? Firstly, analyzing the situation. It is a Section 8 company having charitable objective. So the management contends that Ind AS need not be applied, and hence they are preparing as per the earlier GAAP. They are not applying Ind AS requirements. If you see case study questions like this, for the case study questions like this, you can divide your answer into three parts. Okay, so divide your answer into three parts. In the first paragraph, you can write the provisions. What all are the provisions applicable in the given question? In the second paragraph, you can write the facts of the case, you know, provisions linked to the given scenario. And finally, in the third paragraph, as an auditor, give your conclusion. Okay. So, analyzing the first question which you have just read, what all provisions shall apply for the given scenario? What all provisions shall apply? So, I'm starting my first paragraph saying with a separate heading, provisions. First provision is under section 129 of Companies Act 2013 deals with financial statements. Section 129 tells us that financial statement comprising of balance sheet, statement of P&L, cash flow statement, etc. should be prepared as per Schedule 3, accounting standards, showing true and fair view. So it mentions that financial statements should be prepared as per accounting standards. So a doubt comes, which accounting standard? Those accounting standard that is mentioned under Section 133. 133 of Companies Act deals with central government to prescribe accounting standards. So, linking 129 with Section 133, which says central government to prescribe the accounting standards. Hence, as per Section 129, the financial statement shall be prepared in accordance with accounting standard under Section 133. And the last point in the first paragraph, as per 143, subsection 3, to be more specific, clause E, says us that if financial statement does not comply with accounting standards, auditor has to report. So 143.3 is duty to state in auditor's report if accounting standard has not been complied. So in the first paragraph, we link the section 129, 133 and 143.3 clause E. Coming to the next paragraph, you can write a separate heading, say facts of the case. That is very easy. You have to just reproduce what the situation is. Okay, in the given case, company being a Section 8 company having charitable objective, the management has not prepared financial statement as per Ind AS. So you are just reproducing the facts in the second paragraph. Finally, okay, you will give your conclusion. Okay, as an auditor, what would you conclude? Even though the company is a Section 8 company, it shall prepare financial statement in accordance with Ind AS. If Ind AS is applicable based on the transition provisions criteria, then it has to prepare. Just by stating it is a Section 8 company, it cannot avail the exemption. Hence, as an auditor, you should advise the management. You have to advise the management to comply with Ind AS. If management does not comply, then auditor has to report. Report under 143.3e plus auditor shall modify the report as per SA 705. Hence, auditor will modify the report as per SA 705. Okay. So, here I have just written the section. Whatever section I have written, when it comes for the exam, you have to write the section requirements as such. Okay. So, that's the first question. Moving on to the next question. Question number 2. You have been appointed as a statutory auditor of a company for the financial year ended 31st March 2017 in place of a retiring auditor. Okay. During the course of audit, you observe that a fraud has been committed by a general manager. So what you observe? A fraud has been committed by a general manager who had retired in the year March 2017. While going into further details, it is found that the fraud is going on since last 2 to 3 years and the total amount was likely to exceed 100 lakhs. So the amount is 100 lakhs exceeding, which means the amount is more than 1 crore. Now, coming to the last part. As a statutory auditor, what would be your reporting responsibilities to the government? So, see here, the question is very specific. You know, they have asked, as an auditor, what is your reporting responsibilities to whom? The government. So, if you remember, Provisions of Companies Act, section 143, subsection 12. 143, subsection 12, which states duty to report on frauds. Duty to report on frauds. It states specific procedure if the amount exceeds 1 crore. Mainly there are 4 steps. Immediately report to BOD audit committee. Get information explanation within 45 days. Within next 15 days, report to central government in form 84. And finally, you know, you have to send the speed post in the sealed cover. Okay. So those 4 points you have to explain in the first paragraph of provision. Next para, coming to the facts of the case. Okay. Again, you can reproduce. In the given case, as an auditor, you observe that a fraud has been committed by a general manager who retired in the month of March 17. And the amount you discovered is likely to exceed 100 lakhs, which is 1 crore. So, facts, you can reproduce it here. Okay. Finally, what is your conclusion? Conclusion. Hence, auditor shall report to whom? Auditor shall report to central government as per the above provision. Okay. One of the mistake students do with respect to this question is that they also link the provisions of CARO 2016. If you know CARO 2016, Clause 10. Clause 10 deals with fraud reporting. But here you need not write CARO. Why? Because the question is specific. It is asking us, what is your reporting responsibility to the government? Whereas CARO provisions mainly is reporting to the users. So you need not mention CARO 16. Plus, should we mention SA 240? SA 240 deals with auditor's responsibility relating to fraud. Again, not required. Why? The question is asking you, as an auditor, what is your responsibilities in reporting to government? Hence, you need not refer, or rather you should not refer to CARO 16 or SA 240. Okay. So if this word government was not there, you know, in this question, if the word government was not there, you should have linked with CARO also, plus SA 240. Okay. So that is the second question. Moving on to the next question. Okay. Question number 3. D Limited is a Delhi-based company having a turnover of 25 crores. Okay. Has a branch. Okay. The company has a branch at US having a turnover of 10 lakhs as converted from dollars. The area where the branch is located in USA was severely affected by storms and office along with all accounting records were completely destroyed. Due to the unavailability of records, the financial statement of D Limited for the year 16-17 did not include figures relating to the said branch. As a statutory auditor, how will you report the same? So in the given case, a branch is located in US because of some catastrophe. Okay. Records are destroyed and financial year of 16-17 does not include the details pertaining to the branch. So as an auditor, what is your duty? So here, provisions. If you remember, section 143, subsection 8. 143, subsection 8 of Companies Act. It mainly deals with branch audit. Okay. It says branch auditor shall be appointed by shareholders or authorized to board of directors. Branch auditor can be a person appointed under section 139, person qualified under section 141, or person qualified as per foreign laws. So all these provisions you can write in the first paragraph along with 143 subsection 8. Okay, and 143 subsection 3 clause C. 143 subsection 3 is duty to state and report. Clause C states whether the report of branch office has been sent to him. Him means the main principal auditor. Okay, so you have written the provisions. Now, facts of the case. Okay, again you can reproduce the case stating that because of a storm, some kind of catastrophe, the records were destroyed, and 2016-17 does not include financials relating to the said branch in US. So you reproduce the facts. Now, as a statutory auditor, what will be your conclusion? Okay, even though that 10 lakh, you know, that 10 lakh when compared to 10 lakh of the branch, when compared to the turnover of 25 lakh is not very material. But as an auditor, since one branch has not been audited, shouldn't you state the same in your report? Yes. So, as an auditor, what you have to state? Auditor should report in his audit report that the said branch has not been audited and the report of the US branch he has not received. So that is auditor's duty with respect to this particular question. Okay. So for the question, when you write section 143(8), you have to explain, you know, branch in India, branch outside India, all these provisions, and also link the same with 143(3)(c). Okay, so that is the third question. Moving on to the next question. The auditors of Messrs. Quick Limited succumbed to the pressure of the management in certifying the financial statement with an overstated figure of turnover by not adhering to the cutoff principles of the time scale for the transaction of the year. Okay. On taking cognizance of this act of the auditor, the tribunal under Companies Act 2013 initiated the proceedings against him. Briefly list the powers of tribunal in this respect, including those relating to making orders against the auditor who is found to be guilty. Yeah, when you read the first part of the question, auditors succumb to the pressure of the management in certifying the financial statements. Okay, so this first part, you know, shows that auditor has acted in a fraudulent manner. Or, if you remember, Companies Act provision under section 140 subsection 5. Under section 140 subsection 5, it is removal of auditor by tribunal. You know, lot of provisions are there in that particular subsection 140 subsection 5. In that, a sentence is there. You know, if auditor acted in a fraudulent manner, or if he abated or colluded with any officers or employees of the company. So it's a clear case where auditor had acted in a fraudulent manner along with the officers of the company. So actions under 140 subsection 5 will come into force. So if continuing the provisions of 140 subsection 5, it says, you know, auditor shall be removed, okay, removed auditor will be ineligible for 5 years, plus he will have penalty under section 447. So, again, coming to the second para, facts of the case. Okay. Again, you can reproduce the first part of the question and moving on to the conclusion. They have asked you in the question, if you read the last sentence, see the last sentence, what are the powers of the tribunal? Okay, who's making orders against the auditor? Powers, if you see, they will direct the company to remove. Okay, that is one of the power, direct the company to remove. Okay, then if he is found guilty, then he has to be removed, plus he will be ineligible to be appointed as auditor for 5 years. Ineligible to be appointed as auditor for 5 years, and he will have a penalty under section 447. So this is the power of tribunal. Remove, auditor will be ineligible for 5 years, and he will have a penalty under section 447. 447 is nothing but penalty for fraud. Okay, so that is question number 4. Moving on to the next question, question 5. Messrs. ABC and Co., a firm of CAs comprising of 3 partners, A, B, C, is the statutory auditors of 50 companies as per the details given below. Small companies, they have 10. Private company having paid up capital less than 100 crores, 20. Private company having paid up capital more than 100 crores, 15. Public company, 5. So, you know, 50 companies, they have given you the split. If you see the split, small companies are exempt from the limit of 20 company audits. Okay. Private companies having paid up capital less than 100 crores. Again, this is also exempt from the limit of 20. Private companies having paid up capital more than 100 crores. Yes, this is not exempt. It will be taken in the limit of 20. Public companies, 5. That is also not exempt. Okay. Now, moving on to the question. Mr. A signs the balance sheet of 10 small companies and 10 private companies having paid up capital of less than 100 crores. Mr. B signs the balance sheet of 10 private company having paid up capital less than 100 crores and 5 private company having paid up capital of more than 100 crores. Okay. Mr. C signs the balance sheet of 10 private companies having paid up capital more than 100 crores and 5 public company. Oh, here they have given the split of that 50 audits with respect to A, B and C. Okay. Now, what is the question? Question is, what is the maximum number of audit that a firm as a whole can accept, and what is the maximum number of audit which each individual partners can accept? Okay, so they have asked you 2 questions in the end. Now, analyzing the provisions, as per 141(3)(g) of Companies Act 2013, it states that a person who is in full-time employment shall be disqualified. A person or a partner who holds audit of more than 20 companies shall be disqualified. Okay. So you have to write the limit of 20 audits. There you have to add as per notification. You know, as per notification, the 4 audits are exempted. OPC, small company, dormant company, private company having paid up capital less than 100 crores. So there you will write the provision. Okay. Coming to the facts of the case. Here we can analyze each case. Okay. First, what is the ceiling limit of the firm? I mean firm as a whole. Three partners, A, B, C. They can take 20 audits each. So 3 into 20, which comes to 60. How many audits they have already undertaken? How many audits they have already undertaken? They have undertaken 50. But out of this 50, 10 are small company, which is exempt. 20 are private companies having paid up capital, you know, less than 100 crores. Again, that is also exempt. So 10 plus 20 comes to 30. Then 15 companies are having more than, okay, 15 companies are having more than 100 crores and 5 are public company. So out of 50, ceiling limit, you will take it only as 50 minus 10 minus 20. You will take it only as 20. Because 10 and 20 are exempt. This 10 and this 20. So, balance audit which the firm can undertake is 40. So, this is the answer for your first part of the question. What is the maximum number of audits the firm as a whole can undertake? So, that is 40. Moving on to the second part. What is the maximum number of audits which each individual partner can accept? If you analyze individual partner wise, 20, 20, 20. They can accept 20 each. Now, coming to A. Mr. A signs the balance sheet of 10 small companies, 10 private companies having paid up capital 100 crores. Meaning, this and this are exempt. So, this is the ceiling limit. Huh? Okay. So, if you see the existing audit, A is zero because his both audits are exempt. Okay. Coming to B. B signs the balance sheet of 10 private company having paid up capital less than 100 and 5 private company having paid up capital more than 100. So in case of B, 10 private companies are exempt and only 5 private companies are taken. So 5 will be the existing audit of B. Coming to C. Mr. C signs the balance sheet of 10 private company having paid up capital of more than 100 and 5 public company. If you see, both 10 private companies are not exempt because it exceeds 100. 5 public companies are also not exempt. So the existing audit for C will be 15. So the answer will be remaining audit which each partner can accept. A can accept 20, B can accept 15, and C can accept 5. Okay. So this is the answer to second part. The maximum number of audit which each individual partners can accept. You know, if you count 20 plus 15 plus 5, it comes to 40. Both should be same, no? Individually or firm-wise. Okay. So, moving on to the next question. Comment on the validity of appointment of A as the auditor of ABC Limited in the following situations. Okay. This question is asked for the exam 3 marks each. First question, this is 3 marks. This is 3 marks. Okay. So, first question. Mr. B A partner of A held shares of face value of rupees 1 lakh in DEF Limited, holding company of ABC. Mr. B sold the securities after a period of 45 days from the date of appointment of A as the auditor of ABC. So we'll analyze that and go to the next question. So what is the provision? Partner of A held the shares in DEF Limited. You know, provision will be 141 subsection 3 clause D subclause 1. If you remember, 141 3D 1 says a person, his partner, his relative holding any security or interest in 5 companies, company, holding, subsidiary, associate, subsidiary of such holding company. Okay, so that you will write. Facts of the case. B is the partner of A, held the shares of DEF Limited, which is holding company. Okay, so here partner is holding the shares. If you analyze the company audit rules, okay, it says if relative hold the shares, corrective action shall be taken within 60 days. That also you can add it with provision. This corrective action, okay, is only in case of the relative. Only if it is a relative. So coming to the conclusion, what will you write? Here, the shares are held by the partner. It's not relative. Shares are held by partner and not relative. Hence, no corrective action can be taken. Because the question says, you know, after a period of 45 days from the date of appointment, they sold the security. No. Hence, therefore, the appointment shall be itself invalid. Since they have been already appointed, you should vacate. Vacate under 141 subsection 4. Okay. So, that's the first question. Okay. If the question said it was relative, then you would have had an opportunity to take the corrective action within 60 days. Okay. So, that's the first question. Coming to the second part. Mrs. A, wife of Mr. A, had given a financial guarantee for the principal amount of a debt owed by X to ABC Limited for 6 lakh. X has repaid the 5 lakhs to the company 2 days before the appointment as auditor. Okay. Again, coming to the provision. 141 3D 3. It says a person, his relative, his partner who has given a guarantee for an amount exceeding 1 lakh to company, subsidiary, holding, associate, subsidiary of such holding company shall be disqualified. And one more important sentence there. Qualification or disqualification is seen as on which date? As on date of. Okay, as on date of appointment. Fine. Facts. In the given case, okay, just 2 days before the appointment, X has repaid 5 lakh. Total debt was 6 lakh. 5 he repaid. So, balance is only 1 lakh. So, that is the facts. So, what is the conclusion? Since as on the date of appointment, guarantee does not exceed 1 lakh. The guarantee does not exceed 1 lakh. Hence, appointment of A shall be valid. See, in the given question, instead of 5 lakh, if he had, I'm just correcting the question, 4 lakhs, then the answer would have been his appointment will be invalid. Okay. So I hope this question analysis is clear. If you have any doubts with respect to any questions or queries relating to auditing, you can WhatsApp me to this number, or you can send your queries to my mail ID. Okay, so thank you.
Logic School of Management.